This conference will now be recorded.
Good afternoon to all the participants. It is to remind to all the participants that whoever the participants got the confirmation mail with the unique ID and who maintained the attendance with 80% and with the exam marks of 60% or above will get the digital certificate from AICT. And we will post the attendance in the last 5 minutes of this session. And online assessment will be conducted at 2:30 p.m. The total marks will be 20 marks for a duration of 30 minutes. So participants are requested to join at 2:30 p.m. sharp. And the online assessment will close by 3 p.m. And regarding this session, it is my honor to introduce Professor M. Raghava. Professor M. Raghava is serving as professor in the Department of Computer Science and Engineering at CVR College of Engineering since 2017. He has a total of 17 plus years of work experience as an accomplished teacher in the various positions at CVR College of Engineering. He received a promotion as a senior assistant professor in the year 2007 and associate professor in the year 2008. And he demonstrated the ability to clarify subtle concepts and agility to inspire students towards engineering problem solving, and he received consistent evaluation from the students and the supervisors. He had taught several subjects including numerical methods, DA, theory of computation, IoT, to mention some. And he is a corporate faculty for Infosys Technology, in which he handled advanced Unix programming and shell programming course for the batches in the year 2007. And his research interests include image processing, deep learning, computer vision, sparse representation, semantic query processing, knowledge discovery, and distributed systems. He has published several papers, research papers, in the various international journals and conferences. And he has obtained PhD from the University of Hyderabad in the year 2017. So with his vast experience, now I request Professor M. Raghava sir to hand over the session. Sir, I have made you the presenter. The screen is visible to us, sir. And we need to check the audio from your side. Sir, can you speak something so that we can verify whether your audio is working or not? Microphone is working or not? Sir, your voice is not audible to us.
Sir, your voice is not audible, sir.
Is it okay?
Yes, sir. Now it's clear, sir. Sir, again, it's not audible, sir. Sir, voice is not clear, sir.
The technology as such. Is it? Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay, yeah.
So it's clear, sir.
So is the screen visible? I am sharing my presentation. Hello.
It's visible, sir.
So is it in presentation mode or is it in minimal mode?
Sir, it is in normal window mode, sir.
Window mode. Okay. So shortcut for that. F5, right?
Hope you can see, switch to full screen mode, sir.
And that's what I am trying. Longer time.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, is this visible? Yeah. Now?
Yes, sir. Now it is in full screen mode, sir.
Okay, right.
Now everything is clear, sir.
Everything is clear. Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, so good afternoon, one and all. It is my indeed a pleasure as well as privilege to serve as a resource person in ACT sponsored workshop FTP, okay, under Atal scheme. And I also express my deep gratitude towards the management of the G. Pulariti Engineering College. Okay, so for giving me this particular opportunity to present my intuitions, okay, so to the August audience. Okay, so coming to myself, I'm Raghava. So as the coordinator, convener of this particular FTP, as introduced. Okay, so I'm working for CVR College Engineering. Okay, so and I obtained my PhD from University of Hyderabad. Okay, so under the supervision of Professor Arun Agarwal and Professor C.R. Rao. Okay, so and I'm also blessed to have two eminent people as my DRC members, namely Bapiraju sir and Patil Negi sir. Okay, and so coming to my presentation, okay, so I am going to talk about one challenging as well as the very very interesting problem, namely image in painting, and I am going to address how exactly this particular problem can be solved, okay, by means of a wide variety of techniques, and I am going to elaborate upon two techniques. The first one is the machine learning based approach, and the second one is about deep learning based approach, and I'm going to compare and contrast them, okay, so as to their performance as well as their capabilities. Okay, and so this is the outline of my presentation. Okay, so I'll start my presentation with the preamble of the painting problem. Okay, and then I try to characterize the nature of the problem, and then I am going to highlight upon so how exactly certain characteristics of this problem can be modeled by means of the mathematical methodologies. Okay, and then eventually I will be talking about the machine learning based approach and the deep learning based approach to solve this problem. And the third part of my presentation is about apprising all of you, okay, so related to the challenges, okay, so are the negative side of the so-called the undemocratic employment of the AI. Okay, so this is the with that I will conclude my session. Okay, and so just to bring the problem into the context, so you just see I am presenting two images here. Okay, so the image on the left is a wall painting, and that particular painting suffered from scratches, okay, so due to various reasons. And if you any owner is interested in is recovering that particular image from those scratches, okay, paintings from the scratches, then he employs an individual, okay, who is good at painting. And that artist, what does he do is so he looks at the entire image, okay, or painting, and he utilizes the information available in this particular entire image, okay, or painting, and he fills this particular scratches or gaps, okay, so by applying his intuition. Okay, so this is the first example, okay, so with regard to the preservation of painting. Okay, and we just look at the second example. In this example, you see two images again. In the image on the left hand side, okay, so there are three persons standing, okay, and in the second image you could see that so this particular person who is standing to the extreme right is disappearing. Okay, so the technique behind this particular work or artifact is referred to as the dark room technique. Okay, we also refer to that as air blow technique or air gun technique. Okay, so in this particular air gun technique, okay, so what the photographer, okay, or the developer of this particular negative, okay, into photograph does is he blows air through his mouth, okay, and he tries to disperse the information available at this particular place into the neighboring area, and he also tries to preserve the overall the unity of the image. Okay, you see that on the right hand side, you could see that this gentleman is disappearing, and the wall behind him is being retained. Okay, so and the surface of this particular water, okay, so at this particular water surface is also maintained. Okay, its unity. Okay, so this is about image editing. Okay, and this is the example for object removal from images. Okay, so you see, we all used to learn in our childhood that seeing is believing. Okay, and if you use this particular image, right hand side image, and from by seeing this particular image, if you construe something or if you interpret something out of that, so we are wrong. Okay, so no longer seeing is believing. Okay, that is the point that I want to draw. Okay, so based on those two examples, okay, so now let me introduce the problem statement. Okay, the name of the problem is about in painting. Okay, in fact, it is about image in painting. Okay, so if you look at this diagram here on the right hand side, okay, so let us assume that this entire rectangle box stands for image, and this image is composed of two regions, two disjoint regions. The first region is about phi, and the second region is about omega. Okay, and supposing that this region omega stands for the gap, okay, or the target area that need to get addressed or that need to get tinkered. Okay, and so the phi is the area that corresponds to the area wherein the information need to get retained. Okay, so in other words, what is that we do in painting is we make use of the information available in this this phi region phi, and we try to fill this particular region omega. Okay, so by utilizing the information available in this particular phi. Okay, so this is the high level definition. Okay, in painting. Okay, so if you put that particular formally, okay, so we have got so a row here. Okay, so this particular row is a function. Okay, so stands for image. Okay, which is for which this the domain is about R square, two dimensional real length space, and the range is about R power n, where that n can be either 1 or 3. Okay, with regard to the nature of the images and their representation. If you deal with the gray images, n stands for 1. If it is about color image, that n is about 3. Okay, so because we all know that, based on the color model we work with, it can be either RGB or it can be about CMY, okay, like that. Okay, so this n can be 3. Okay, and this image I is composed of two functions, okay, which are working on two different or independent regions, namely omega and phi. This is what you could see here. Okay, this phi omega is the place where information is available. Oh, sorry, phi omega is the way area where information to get generated. Okay, and phi omega f phi is about the image area where the information is available. Okay, so the our goal is to you make use of this phi omega f omega f phi, and from those two we want to approximate the original image f. Okay, so this is the overall definition of in painting problem. Okay, so given f omega and f phi, okay, so we are asked to create an approximation for f, okay, so which is represented as f caret. Okay, and that process is referred to as in painting. Okay, so from this particular definition you can easily make out that okay, we are developing a process p which is able to approximate the underlying image from two pieces of information, namely f omega and f phi. Okay, so the goal, the ultimate goal of this algorithm is about the upon completion of this algorithm, the result must be visually meaningful, and the overall content of that particular image, okay, must satisfy some criteria. Okay, so we refer to that as unity. Okay, so our global uniformity, the entire image after successful execution of the algorithm, in painting algorithm, okay, must be uniform with regard to some sense. Okay, so what is that sense? Okay, so that depends on the nature of the image, and it also depends on the expectation of the viewer. Okay, so this is what image in painting is all about. Okay, and I have already given the definition of a formal definition of this image. Okay, so whenever we solve some problems, okay, using engineering methods, so obviously we need to characterize the merit of that particular engineering solution in terms of certain metrics or measures. Okay, so and in some situations we may not be arrive at, or we may not be in a position to derive such metrics. Okay, in that case we make use of the visual inspection to ascertain the goodness of the algorithm. Okay, so and the overall the algorithm performance, okay, so is specified in terms of fidelity, and that fidelity can be measured in terms of visual inspection or in terms of some measures. Okay, and this is the end overall procedure of in painting. Okay, so what is that we have is we have got an input image, and it has got some gaps to get filled, and the system may not be in a position to understand as to where to fill. In that case, a user has to specify the area, okay, where the touch up need to get taken up. Okay, so that is specified in terms of mask. Okay, so we need to specify the mask, and once these two inputs are given to the inbuilt algorithm, the algorithm will fill this particular inbuilt region with meaningful content and it generates the output image. Okay, so this is the typical framework of image inventing, and this particular framework is not similar to image restoration. Okay, so we all learned in our image processing data. So with regard to image processing framework, so there are a sequence of steps involved. The first step is about image enhancement, and then the second step is about image restoration, and then feature extraction and so on. Okay, so this particular framework is not complying with the regular image processing problem, okay, so especially with regard to image enhancement. Okay, so in case of image enhancement, at some areas we have got data, also the data is corrupted due to noise. Okay, so given data plus noise, we are trying to understand the characteristic of the noise, and we are trying to remove that particular noise from the image by means of applying different types of filters. Okay, so and that particular noise can be because of varieties of reasons. One of the reasons could be about out of focus blur, or it could be because of the motion blur. Okay, so according to the underlying problem, okay, so we need to develop appropriate filters that are capable of handling this motion blur or out of focus blur, and we try to apply some inverse operation on that, and then we can get the better result. That is what image restoration or image enhancement is all about. Okay, so especially image enhancement, restoration. Okay, so this particular image inpainting is not complying with that particular framework, because in the inpaint region I don't have information at all. Okay, so that is totally blank, whereas in the case of image restoration we have got some information, okay, which is being corrupted with noise. Okay, so there we need to understand or characterize the nature of the noise, and we remove that particular noise by applying some inverse transformation. Okay, but whereas here in case of image inpainting, so in the inpaint region there is no information at all. Okay, this is the first point you have to understand. Okay, so this is the point that is making the problem complicated. Okay, and so as I already mentioned, with regard to the solution of this particular problem, okay, so the solution can be characterized in terms of peak signal to noise ratio measure, or we also have got SSIM, okay, which can assess the result of the algorithm based on the structures. Okay, so the SSIM refers to a structural similarity index measure. Okay, and if source image is not known, okay, then only we need to rely upon the visual inspection. Okay, and coming to the properties of this problem, as I already mentioned, this is an example for inverse problem. Okay, so here we have got some input with us, input image with us, and that input image need to get manipulated. Okay, and so as to how that particular image need to get manipulated, I don't know, because I don't have the ground truth with me. Okay, so we need to understand so the process, okay, that has made noise being introduced into this particular image, and we have to undo that particular process. So that is what inverse problem is all about. And moreover, this problem is also imposed because for this problem I don't have unique solution. Okay, so I'll get in number of solutions, and and at the same time no solution is perfect. So such problems are called as imposed problems. And also, so if you change some parameter by small value, okay, so the output of the algorithm might change drastically. Okay, so that is also one of the characterization for imposed problems. Okay, so in order to overcome that, okay, so in order to overcome that particular an unusual perturbation problem, okay, what is that we do is we apply some regularization principles on the nature of the solution, and we try to gain control on the behavior of the algorithm. Okay, so this is what the ill-posed problems are all about. Okay, so whenever I construe that a problem is imposed, then what is that I do is I impose some regularization mechanisms on top of that algorithm of the problem, and I gain control on the solution. Okay, so and whatever efforts you do, okay, so those efforts might fail, okay, so they might go in vain if the problem, okay, so exhibits certain non-stationarity. Okay, so I'll elaborate what all these words are about in the subsequent slides. Okay, so this is the set of identified properties of the problem, and so the literature is enriched with a lot of mathematical as well as computational intuitions. Okay, and so if you look at the solution space of this particular problem, okay, so the taxonomy is classified into four categories. The first category is certain algorithms, they are able to retain the geometry of the structures in the image, and certain algorithms try to synthesize the texture in the image, and another set of solutions, they try to preserve the geometry as well as synthesize the texture concurrently, and another set of ideas, they are all about hybrid ideas that combine all the three aspects that have been shown over here. Okay, so this is the contributions made by the researchers in this particular problem. So this problem is very young, relatively young. So this word named inpainting was coined in 2000. Okay, it's just 20 years old. Okay, and as I already mentioned, so whenever we want to handle any repose problem, okay, then we need to arrive at some control theory, okay, and we need to impose some regularization policy on that, and that particular regularization policy is based on certain physical phenomena. Okay, so before you apply some regularization mechanism on the solution, first of all you have to understand the physical phenomena behind the problem. Okay, so and as far as this inpainting problem is concerned, this problem possesses a property, namely anisotropy property. Okay, so this anisotropy word refers to dependency of information availability, okay, on the direction also. Okay, so we always know that so the information, okay, in spatial area or in spatial data, okay, changes from location to location. Okay, and at the same time we are also talking about the variability of the data, okay, so in along with the direction also. Okay, so in addition to this particular distance, okay, so such property is called as anisotropy property. You all engineers appreciate this word. You must have encountered this word anisotropy in at multiple discussions, okay, in your engineering course. Okay, and so this particular anisotropy can be modeled, okay, so by means of partial differential equations, or by means of total variation minimization, or by means of self-similarity. Okay, so by using three different intuitions, okay, so the first two are purely physical phenomena. Okay, so they are physicist intuitions, and the last one, namely self-similarity, is purely a computer science problem. Okay, so we are going to see how exactly the physical phenomena as well as a computational intuition, okay, or intelligence help us to solve this problem. Okay, so if you take up that particular partial differential equations one, okay, so what is that we do here is, okay, so supposing that this particular blue area stands for inpainted region, and the light blue area, this gray area, stands for source region. I want to fill this particular blue area by using the information available in this gray area. Then what is that we do is, we look at the boundary of this particular inpainted region, and we try to slowly propagate information available in the source region into the inpainted region. Okay, so this is what the inpainting is all about. And in the course of transferring the information from one location to another location, what is that I am using is, I am making use of the gradient operator and the direction of the gradient operator, and the information will get propagated perpendicular to the gradient operator. This is what that is being shown here. You see, this del I is about gradient, and I am looking at the perpendicular. We refer to that as normal. Along the normal direction, I am simply propagating the smoothness. We all know that Laplacian operator stands for smoothness. This del I is about smoothness information. Okay, this smoothness information is propagated along the normal, okay, at the boundary of this particular event region. And I repeatedly do that until so the change okay reaches to zero. Okay, so I stop this algorithm, this iterative algorithm, once this particular condition, the boundary condition is met. That boundary condition is about, so the changes are not visible. Okay, so once the changes are not visible, then I stop my algorithm. Okay, this is about PDE based approach. Okay, so whatever I mentioned just now, that is being represented in the form of a diagram. Okay, so I want to fill this area. So what is that I am doing? I am looking at the edges, okay, gradient operator, and I propagate the information along the normals into this particular event region from the source region. Okay, so this is how my algorithm works. Okay, so and the boundary condition for stopping my algorithm is also well defined. Okay, and the second model with regard to PDE is about total variation. Okay, so this total variation, okay, so we all know that total variation is the sum of the local differences. Okay, so this particular del operator here, okay, so we all know that this del operator can be represented in terms of or it can be implemented in terms of forward difference, backward difference, and central difference. Okay, so if you use forward difference, okay, and if you compute these forward differences at all locations and if you sum them up, what is that you get is total variation. Okay, so the total variation is represented in terms of integral over here because it is a continuous function. In case of discrete, we represent that as a summation symbol. Okay, so what is that we try to do is, okay, so we try to compute the total variation across the entire image and we try to reduce that particular total variation. Okay, so the total variation is represented in terms of energy and I want to minimize that energy. Okay, so in order to minimize that energy, again I evolve a simple iterative solution. Okay, and that particular iterative solution involves a special operator, namely here, the G here. This G stands for curvature. Okay, I'm going to demonstrate that by means of this diagram. Okay, so I want to fill this region. Okay, so and what is that I have to do is I have to propagate these incoming edges. Okay, and I must ensure that, okay, so the point on this boundary at this particular location must get joined with a point on this edge at this location by means of this particular line. Okay, so in fact this is not line, this is a curvilinear line. Okay, so if you don't put this curvature term, this kappa term here, whatever the kappa term that is represented, this kappa stands for curvature. If you don't put that curvature term in the solution, what is that we end up with is we are able to join the point on this boundary. Okay, so okay, this point will get joined with this point at this by means of a straight line. Okay, so thereby what is that we are unable to do is we are unable to preserve the entire structure of this particular curve. Okay, so just to overcome that problem, so the designers, okay, the engineers have introduced that kappa term, okay, so namely curvature term. Okay, so using that curvature we can do a curve. Okay, and the one more aspect of this image in painting is related to the real world application. Okay, we all know that images are always represented in terms of the quotients. Okay, the predominantly used transformations are wavelet transforms. And so translate is represented in terms of transfer image from location to another location. We transmit the image from one location to another location. Okay, so answer is noisy. Then if you receive wavelet quotients on such a noisy channel, okay, there is a chance that some quotients might get lost altogether. Okay, so if you reconstruct the image based on the remaining wavelet quotients, okay, so you might get such a low quality image. Okay, so now given such a low quality image which is reconstructed from quotients, wavelet quotients, in which many of are missing, okay, then it is of low quality. Then I want to get the original image back. Okay, so in fact, I can't get the original image back. Okay, so but I want to improve the enhance the quality of the image. Okay, so what is that I do is I apply my TV minimization algorithm. Okay, so to reconstruct the last wavelet coefficients, and I can improve the image quality. Okay, so I had implemented this algorithm sometime back. Okay, and so I have got a computational improvement with regard to the original algorithm proposed by Tony Chan. Okay, so and coming to the third intuition, namely best exemplar are self-similarity measures. Okay, so this is purely a computer science problem. Okay, so I want to fill this particular region omega by utilizing the information available in this particular region phi. Then what is that I do is I look at the boundary of this particular in-paint region, and I place a patch on top of this particular in-paint region boundary. Okay, and I ensure that the center of my patch is aligned with one of the points on the boundary. And by using the information, by utilizing the information available in the vicinity of this particular boundary, okay, what is that I do is I look for similar signatures in the entire source region of my image, and if I am able to get a matching template, okay, complying with the signature present in this particular patch, okay, then what is that I do is I copy the information into this particular source region. Thereby, so few pixels of my in-paint region will get filled with the information from source region. I repeat this, okay, until the omega, okay, so is non-zero, non-null set. Okay, so this is the simple algorithm. Okay, so it is just about copy paste algorithm. Okay, so I look for best matching patch, okay, in the source region. Once it is found, I am simply copying that into my target region. Okay, but the algorithm seem to be simple, but so if you implement this in a naive manner, okay, so it suffers from lot of artifacts. Okay, so there are a lot of issues related to this intuition. Okay, and the first intuition is about, so as to which particular pixel on the boundary you are going to select as the target patch. Okay, so in order to determine that, we all know that, okay, so whenever there is a contention, okay, so with regard to as to which particular element need to get processed first, then immediately we go for priority, and we need to evolve some certain priority term. Okay, and based on the priority term, we can choose the pixel that need to get selected on the boundary, okay, to get filled first. Okay, so that particular priority can be modeled by means of two terms, namely data term and confidence term. Okay, so these two terms are very simpler to interpret. Okay, so if my patch, target patch and the boundary has got more number of source region pixels, my confidence is more. Okay, my confidence is more. And inside that particular source region pixels, if there is some edge, okay, information available, okay, then that is the point that need to get targeted first. So that is, we call it as data term. Okay, so using this confidence term and data term, okay, so we can determine the priority of a pixel, okay, or a patch on the boundary. Okay, and once that particular patch is selected, and that particular patch will get targeted, and it will get replaced with an exemplar, best exemplar, okay, which is available in source region. Okay, and I can fill the in-paint region slowly. Okay, so the significance of two terms, confidence term and data term, are represented pictorially over here. Okay, this particular area, okay, so has got more number of in-paint region pixels, whereas if you take up a point or boundary point from this particular area, so it will have more number of in source region pixels. Okay, so and if you take up this, you also have got edge information. So that is why, so the confidence term and data term are very critical, okay, to determine the priority of the boundary itself. Okay, so, and once the priority is finalized, the target patch is selected, and with regard to that target patch, we need to look for an exemplar patch in the source region. And out of all similar patches available, we are going to pick a best exemplar by means of solving this simple minimization problem. Okay, so I am going to pick a target patch. Okay, so XIP, and okay, so I am going to pick a best exemplar from the source region XIQ. Okay, which is very similar to the XIP. Okay, so this is a simple analogy with regard to the selecting the best exemplar. Okay, so you see, whatever I have mentioned so far, all of them are purely computer science statements. Okay, and so the behavior of that algorithm is demonstrated over here. Okay, so if you select a point, okay, on this boundary, okay, so on this boundary, okay, so and if the point happened to be here, so you could see there is a lot of confidence as well as data, both of them are high over here. And if you construct a patch around that particular point, and if you try to look for best exemplars in the source region, okay, so the best exemplar search location as the target, as the source region patch, and I copy the information from this particular area into this area, and thereby I can fill portion of my inbound region, and simultaneously I am ensuring that the incoming edge is getting preserved. Okay, this is what my data term is all about. Okay, so there is some in surprise that in terms of data, that data I am exploiting. Okay, so this is how my exemplar works. Okay, and this particular best exemplar solution has been improved. Okay, so by means of putting this entire problem as a random field problem, and so they have injected the Markovian property into this particular random field, and on that particular random field, people have invoked an algorithm, namely belief propagation algorithm, to solve this problem. Okay, so we all must work with this particular area. So this is very happening area in computer science, Markov random fields, especially with regard to the computer vision as well as the image processing problems. So most of the problems can be modeled on this particular field, namely Markov random field. And that particular field offers us a lot of tools to solve certain high level problems. Okay, so, and one of the algorithms available or evolved on top of this Markov random field is about belief propagation. By using this belief propagation, we can solve this problem. Okay, so there is a simple equation here. Okay, so instead of elaborating that, I'll demonstrate that in terms of the data. Okay, so see, this belief propagation works like this. Okay, so supposing that there are sequence of rectangular arrangement of pixels, and some pixels are corrupted with zero values. Okay, and if you want to fill those corrupted values, okay, so lost values, then what is that I do is I make use of information available in the vicinity. Okay, so that particular intuition can be implemented in terms of message passing. Okay, so here I'm showing that. So see, let us assume that at location Q, I don't have information. So then what is that I do is I make use of the information available in the neighborhood. Okay, so I get influenced, Q get influenced by P. Okay, so that particular influence is in terms of message. Okay, P is sending a message to Q. Okay, that message is about MPQ. Okay, and similarly, P also will get influenced by its own neighbors. Okay, namely STR. Okay, see, S, T, R are also sending messages to this P, and P also has got its own intuition, its own cognitive behavior. Okay, so it gets influenced by its neighbors, and also it has got its own cognitive behavior. Okay, the overall social as well as cognitive behaviors is totaled, and the total result or the summative knowledge will get transferred to the Q in terms of NP. Okay, so this is what the belief propagation algorithm is all about. Okay, so using such a simple algorithms, okay, so we are able to solve many real world problems. So for example, even in social networks also, okay, so how exactly a gossip will get spread in the social network, and how exactly one individual can influence another individual, okay, by means of sending certain messages. Okay, all that can be modeled by means of this particular philosophy, namely Mark or random fields, and on top of that, the algorithm that I evolved. Okay, so using this particular Mark or random field philosophy also, people have tried to solve the impending problem, and so they have got better results. Okay, and if you are interested in extending your knowledge on this Mark or random fields, okay, there are very good books available in the literature. Okay, so one of them is about Andrew Blake, the Mark or random fields by Andrew Blake, and there is one more book by the Coakley. Okay, Coakley also has written one more book on Mark or random fields. Okay, you can download and you can go through that. Okay, and another example for the solution space is about a very widely used algorithm, namely batch match algorithm. Okay, if you look at Adobe Photoshop, this particular algorithm is implemented in this Adobe Photoshop. Okay, so in this, you see, I have got an image, okay, which has got damaged structures. Okay, and I want to improve the quality of this particular image in terms of the structures. Then what is that I do is, I can give clues to this algorithm. Okay, I am giving a clue. Okay, in terms of lines, some strokes. Okay, based on those strokes, my algorithm can fill these regions. Okay, so the broken regions. Okay, so you see, so this is the original image, and there are certain holes, and the holes are specified along with certain clues. Okay, in terms of constraints, by using this holes information as well as constraint information, this batch match algorithm can quickly fill this particular area. Okay, so, and you could see this is the output of that particular batch match algorithm. Okay, and if you want to appreciate how exactly that algorithm works, it is simply based on the best exemplar again. And instead of searching at every location of the source region, what batch match does is it looks at the target area, target patch, and compares with one best exemplar. Once best exemplar is found, then the patches around that particular best exemplar will get copied. Okay, so without verifying for the similarity and all. Okay, thereby I can improve upon the performance of the algorithm. Okay, so coming to the next one is about the second machine learning model. Okay, so it works based on the histograms. Okay, so I want to remove this particular statue in front of this building. Okay, so I have specified that in terms of the target area, and in course of filling this particular target area, then what this algorithm, okay, developed by he does is, okay, so it simply computes the histogram. It constructs the histogram of the best matching patches. Okay, and it is going to select the patches from the tallest histogram. Okay, so you see, you could see here that the offsets of all these patches are mentioned in terms of histogram, and the patches that are falling into tallest tower, okay, of this particular histogram, they will get selected. Okay, this is what statistics of a patch offset. We are simply arriving at the summary of the statistics related to the offsets in terms of histogram, and that histogram is helping us in selecting the source patch or exemplar patch. Okay, so this is also a beautiful algorithm. Okay, so there is a scope for improvement in this algorithm also. If you are interested in that, you can download this paper, and you can work on that. You can implement that very easily, and this particular algorithm also work in real time. Okay, and the another philosophy is about given input image, instead of worrying about the structures or textures independently, what is that we can do is we can target both the elements of my image simultaneously. Okay, so by means of an algorithm namely MCA, morphological component analysis. Okay, so this particular paper was published in 2005. Okay, so as far as this problem is concerned, so given an input image, what this morphological component analysis does is it extracts structure component and texture component separately. Okay, it extracts both the components, and the inpainting algorithm will get launched on both the components simultaneously. Okay, now you could see here, so this is the input image, okay, Barbara image, and it has got texture component, also structure component, Okay, so instead of calling it as a structure component, we are using the word named cartoon component, smooth component. Okay, so both these components are addressed independently, okay, targeted independently, and the partial results will get combined to get the overall result. Okay, this is the implemented image. Okay, so this is also one of the intuitions. Okay, so this also works efficiently. Okay, so and so how is that you separate this texture from structure? Okay, that is also a big area in signal processing. Okay, so this particular image signal will get passed through dictionary of atoms, and each atom is implemented in terms of a transformation. Okay, so that transformation could be about a wavelet transformation, discrete cosine transformation, curvelet transformation, and so on. Okay, what is that I do is I construct a dictionary, okay, which is composed of atoms. Each atom stands for a basis of a transformation, and once the signal, the image signal gets passed through this particular dictionary, okay, so based on the nature of that particular signal, one particular atom will get activated, and it gives a larger response when compared to other atoms. Thereby, I am able to separate the components present in the image. Okay, so this is the very latest area with regard to signal processing. Okay, construction of dictionaries and the application of that particular dictionaries to represent images or signals in a sparse manner is a challenging area. It's a happening area in signal processing. Okay, so you could see literature related to that. Okay, so Donahoe and Shapiro, okay, they have pioneered in this particular area, okay, with regard to sparse representation of signals and solving the image and painting problem through that particular modality, namely sparse representations. Okay, so and again, there is a real question, real challenge. How do you design the dictionaries? Okay, so what should be the characteristic of the basis to get inserted into this particular dictionary as an atom? That is also a big issue. Okay, and how do you look at the representation of the signal? Okay, so they are all involved issues. Okay, so in signal processing. Okay, so you can refer to the literature. Okay, so if you are interested in this particular area. Okay, and so even using that particular the dictionaries. Okay, so I can decompose the images into different domains based on the nature of the content. Okay, and then I can address different components independently. Okay, so that is the dictionary based approaches. Okay, so the crux of that particular dictionary based approaches is to represent the signals in a sparse manner. So we refer to that area as a sparse representations. Okay, and there are a lot of mathematical properties we need to verify before employing this particular sparse representations. And even the solutions are also optimized with regard to some other set of properties. Okay, so let us not go into those properties. Okay, so we have a lot of time to explore all of them thoroughly if you are interested in that area. Okay, similarly, in image processing, the recent intuition is to use non-local characteristics. Okay, so instead of solving TV memorization locally, why can't we use non-local TV memorization? Okay, so this is what you must have heard about non-local means. Okay, so those algorithms are more intuitive, are more capable when compared to the local TV memorization as well as local means algorithms. Okay, so people have applied non-local TV memorization by means of combining the exemplary approach with TV minimization, and they were able to get better results. Okay, so this is the entire literature with regard to the problem. Okay, now coming to the intuition that we can give towards this problem, so is about why can't we model this problem as a machine learning problem? Okay, and why can't we apply some machine learning algorithm on top of this particular problem to get results? Okay, so I have taken up that intuition, and just to solve the problem, what is that I have done first is I have understood the wide varieties of the instances of the same problem. Okay, so in what forms this image painting problem is appearing, okay, in real world, And all those instances I try to classify. Okay, so by looking at the literature and by looking at the real world problems, I simply categorized the inpainting problem in terms of scratch removal, text removal, object removal. Okay, and there is one more interesting problem associated with this inpainting is about object retargeting. Okay, so you see, supposing that there are two people, a boy and girl sitting on a bench, okay, one on the one side and the second boy, girl on the other side, okay, and by using it, if I take a photograph of that particular two students in the classroom, okay, and what is that I can do is I can make them to appear as closer to each other by means of object retargeting. Okay, so actually both the students are sitting apart, and what is that I am doing by taking a photograph of that particular scene and by applying this particular image in painting or image retargeting, object retargeting, what is that I can ensure is, or I make both the objects to appear closer. Okay so and similarly, if boy is sitting onto the right and girl is sitting to the left, I can shuffle them. Okay, so and I can confiscate. Okay, so or I can also cheat others by means of these evidences. Okay, counterfeit evidences. Okay, so that is what. So we must not believe in the images. Okay, so seeing is never believing. Okay, so as far as the current scenario is concerned. Okay, so this is the categorization of inpainting problems. And also, I have come up with the classes of that particular image in paintings. Okay, so based on the morphological features of that particular inpaint region. The inpaint region is very small and it is single in number. Okay, this is one class. If the image regions, inpaint regions are smaller, but there are multiple such regions, I have coined them into second category, second class. Similarly, so there are multiple and multiple inpaint regions, and each and every one of them is small. Third one is about there is a single inpaint region, but it is large in size, arbitrary shape. Okay, similarly, so there are two more classes of inpainting. Okay, so I have understood that particular categories and classes, and then I wanted to represent this particular problem, okay, in terms of machine learning algorithm. And as I already mentioned, before venturing into any algorithm, first of all, you have to model the anisotropy. Okay, so, and the anisotropy that I want to model here is about spatial anisotropy. Okay, so this spatial anisotropy, the word spatial refers to the location. Okay, so that spatial anisotropy I have utilized while talking about the similarity. Okay, and I was arriving at similarity measures. Also, while solving this problem with an interpolation problem, okay, so I coined this interpolation as spatial interpolation. Okay, so and even to handle the curse of dimensionality, we normally go for sampling in many machine learning algorithms. Okay, and the sampling mechanism is also satisfying this particular anisotropy property. Okay, so this is my overall intuition, and using that particular three intuitions, okay, so I wanted to represent this problem, or I wanted to tune this problem, inpainting problem, as interpolation problem. And this is not a regular interpolation, rather it is anisotropic interpolation, and that anisotropy is also realized in terms of spatial properties. So that is why I refer to the algorithm as a spatial anisotropic interpolation. Okay, so you might be wondering, how come such a simple interpolation problem or model is able to solve such a niche problem, okay, namely inpainting. Okay, so, but take it a point, okay, if you understand the characteristics of the problem, and if you do this particular feature engineering properly, okay, so simpler solutions, okay, so simpler machine learning solutions are able to solve complex real world problems. Okay, so this is what some Roser principle. Okay, so don't try to jump upon complex solutions for simple problems. Okay, if the problem is simple, you try to solve it by means of simpler means. Okay, so So I followed that particular Rouser principle, and I wanted to solve this problem by means of interpolation. But I cannot directly employ a regular interpolation, okay, because this problem is ill-posed and it satisfies a lot of characteristics. Okay, so that is why I have imposed the regularity, okay, regularization in terms of spatial anisotropy. Okay, so now you could see here, so just to model the problem, what is that I am coming up with is these notations I am introducing. Okay, so the all locations at which information is available, okay, I am representing that as source region. X is a set of all pixel locations where information is available, and Y stands for the actual information that is available at all those locations. Y is about the responses at all those locations. And supposing that I don't have information at a particular location, okay, and I want to impute that information at that location by means of interpolation. Okay, this is the simple idea I had. Okay, so and in order to solve this problem, what is that I can do is, okay, in order to impute a value at unknown location X, okay, so what is that I do is I make use of information available around, okay, in terms of Y, and I take up a linear combination of all those values at those locations, and I try to predict the value of the function at this location X. Okay, so this is what you could see here. I am predicting the value of the function, okay, at unknown location X by means of Y caret, okay, by utilizing the information available in the neighborhood, okay, and that neighborhood information is represented in terms of vector Y. And so those piece of information is taken, okay, as a linear combination. Okay, so the C transpose Y is a linear combination of all these Ys. And so finally, I need to arrive at what this C vector, okay, is representing or speaking about. Okay, so my solution is about constructing this particular C to satisfy the characteristics of the imputed value at this location X. Okay, so this is the overall idea. Okay, so I'm taking the weighted average of the information available in the neighborhood, okay, to impute the value at unknown location X. Okay, so this particular problem is solved, okay, so by means of this spatial anisotropic interpolation. And so this particular spatial anisotropic interpolation is widely used by geoscientists, okay, geological people. Okay, and they refer to this particular algorithm as Kriging algorithm. Okay, so this algorithm is named after the inventor of this particular method, okay, geological scientist named Kriging. Okay, so he modeled this problem as a spatial anisotropic interpolation problem, wherein there are two regressions involved. Okay, so this Kriging has got two phases in it. The first phase is about we need to fit a polynomial regression. Okay, and once you fit a polynomial regression, we all know that polynomial regression suffers from the outliers, and it also has got associated with its own error. Okay, and that particular error I want to minimize. In the course of minimizing that particular error, what is that I am doing is, so we implement one more regression at those error values. Okay, we refer to that as residual regression. Okay, so this combination, namely polynomial regression and residual regression, together is referred to as Kriging. Okay, so this is very widely used by geologists, okay, to predict the availability of certain natural resources at different locations. Okay, so and if I represent that particular Kriging, okay, so in terms of mathematical equation, you see I am able to impute or predict the value of a function at location unknown location X in terms of Y caret X by means of the residual regression. G of X stands for the residual space, okay, a random field. And this second term is about the polynomial regression. Here you could see that this F stands for some polynomial basis, okay, and for some polynomial basis, and we need to compute the quotients of this particular basis. Okay, so with that I can complete my polynomial regression. And while implementing this polynomial regression, I must ensure that the residues are also minimal. Okay, so I want to minimize the error simultaneously. Okay, so the regular regression will not handle this particular Z of X model explicitly. Okay, the regular regressions assume that the error is white noise. Okay, so that means the error is independent of the location. Okay, so at all locations, error remains same as far as our regular regression is concerned. But as far as the spatial regression is concerned, okay, so by modeling the nature of the error, okay, so residual space, I can impose certain characteristics. Those characteristics are about anisotropic characteristics. Error is not independent of the location. Error is dependent of the location. Also, I can also evaluate whether that error is also dependent upon the direction also, direction or not. Okay, by combining all these intuitions, okay, I can enhance the capabilities of the regression, and such an enhanced regression is called as a spatial regression. Okay, so this particular spatial regression solution, okay, so as I already mentioned, I have to solve this particular polynomial regression first, and this polynomial regression I am solving by means of accommodating the spatial characteristics, and one of the spatial characteristics I am accommodating is about correlation, and this correlation is again the spatial correlation. Okay, so here you see I am coming up with normal equations for this particular beta caret. Okay, so I am approximating the coefficients of this polynomial regression, okay, by means of this normal equation. Okay, so in this particular normal equation, you see a special term which we normally don't see in normal equations of regressions. That is about R inverse. This R stands for correlation, and even that correlation is spatial correlation. Okay, so this normal equation we have to solve, and this is at the polynomial regression level. And that particular polynomial regression solution is also not regular solution, ordinary least squares solution. Rather, it is about generalized least squares solution. And similarly, with regard to this minimization of the error, we need to impose certain characteristics. One of the characteristics or one of the property that we need to impose is about best linear unbiased estimation. Okay, so the blue property. Once I impose blue property on this particular z of x, my y caret is going to assume this particular form, closed form. Okay, so I can combine these two into a single form, and I can solve the problem. Okay, so this is what Kricking is all about. Okay, so Kricking is superior to the regular regression in terms of two characteristics. The first characteristic is the error is being modeled as a random field in case of Kricking, whereas polynomial regression or regular ordinary regression treats error as a white noise. Okay, so and the second property, second improvement with regard to this particular polynomial regression is in terms of the anisotropy property. Okay, so the imputation, okay, so is determined by the values available in the neighborhood, and those values are also, okay, so governed by the distance as well as direction. So there are two properties we are going to exploit to impute the value at unknown location. Okay, this is about the spatial characteristic of the solution. Okay, so whatever I have talked about that has been shown here in terms of these equations. If you take up regular regression, ordinary regression, the regression coefficients are simply computed by using F transpose F whole inverse and F transpose Y. Okay, if you want to impose this particular generalized least square solution, okay, so then what that I have to do is I have to impute the beta coefficients. Okay, I have to construct the beta coefficients by accommodating the correlation among all the spatial locations. Okay, so by means of using this particular normal equation, I get better beta coefficients. Okay, so this is what I am talking about with regard to Kricking. And the important point that you have to understand is what actually this F stands for. Okay, so that F is, as I already mentioned, the F stands for basis, regression basis. That could be a polynomial basis, or it could be a spline basis, for that matter, any basis that satisfies certain minimal properties of a basis. Okay, so one of the basis I am showing here, okay, so F basis is being shown here. This basis is polynomial basis, and that polynomial is second order. Okay, it's the full second order because my basis is about order 2. You could see xi square, yi square. Also, we have got the cross term, namely xi, yi. So this is why it is called as full second order multivariate polynomial. Okay, so my basis is a second order polynomial with the cross product term also. Okay, if you use such a basis, then all we need to do is we need to talk about the coefficients of all these terms. Okay, so and with regard to the model of this residual, okay, so we all know that residual is about the actual, so the imputed value minus actual value. Okay, so if I will take up the ordinary generalized least square solution of that, okay, so we are going to get a closed form of that. So let us not go into the details of that closed form. Okay, and the overall result, okay, of my Kriging, okay, so is going to assume this particular shape. Okay, y caret of x is f transpose beta caret plus r transpose r inverse y minus f beta transpose. Okay, so there is a new term for you, namely small r. As I have already talked about this capital R. Capital R stands for the spatial correlation among all the locations, and this small r stands for the correlation of the unknown location. Okay, so I am talking about the correlation with regard to the unknown location with all other locations. Okay, in terms of R, small r, and all known locations are correlated by means of capital R. Okay, so small r is a column vector, whereas capital R is about two-dimensional vector. Okay, so using this particular model, okay, so we can solve the Kriging equation. Okay, so fortunately, so we need not implement all these equations on our own. Okay, so there are a lot of toolboxes available. One of the toolbox that is available in the literature is about DACE. DACE stands for, okay, design and analysis of computer experiments. Okay, so by using this particular toolbox, you can implement these equations or these particular intuitions. And all you need to do is you need to handcraft the parameters, okay, the model parameters as well as hyperparameters of this particular model to get the better results. Okay, so with this, so the understanding of the DACE model is over. Okay, and while solving any machine learning problem, okay, so we all know that there is a trade-off. Okay, so we need to address this particular issue, namely bias variance trade-off. Okay, so so my Kriging model is about a blue model, best linear unbiased model. Okay, so whenever we try to fit the unbiased model, okay, so if you fit the unbiased model, then what is that we are ensuring is my model is going to pass through all the design sites. Okay, and once I fit the model, and if I test the model on test samples, okay, and test cases, the variance of that particular results, the responses will be very high. This is about bias variance trade-off. If you aspire for unbiased solution which passes through all the data points, then obviously the resulting model suffers from high variance. Okay, so that is unavoidable. Similarly, if you try to minimize the variance, then we have to compromise on the bias. Okay, we need to have bias. Okay, so this is the bias variance trade-off. That trade-off is represented over here. Okay, so if you try to reduce the bias, if you implement unbiased solution, then variance will go high. Okay, during testing. Okay, and so this is about the training. Okay, so bias can get addressed during training, and we need to live with high variance if in case of high unbiased solutions. Okay, so but none of them is good for us. We need to strive for a balance, strike a balance between them. Okay, that balance is represented in terms of this particular curve. Okay, so we have to strike this particular balance. Okay, so if you go for overfit solution, it suffers from high variance. High variance is about overfitting. Okay, so it is about underfit, is about the high bias. Okay, so none of them is good. So we need to have a solution with a good balance between both the aspects. Okay, low bias and low variance. Okay, so how do you arrive at that? As I already shown, so instead of using a polynomial that passes through all the points, or a polynomial which passes through only few points. Okay, so instead of using such polynomials, if you use such a polynomial, curve linear polynomial, okay, so then we get better results. Okay, so here itself you could understand how do you get such a basis. Okay, so I'm striking my point over here. Okay, so how do I select this particular basis from the data? Okay, so I have got data points with me, and which particular basis I need to choose for this particular problem. Okay, so that is really a challenge for machine learning, right? Okay, and so in order to do that, so we need to depend upon alternative models, alternative mechanisms. Okay, so what, as I already mentioned, if I look at this particular polynomial regression, and if I impose certain properties, okay, so due to paucity of time, I cannot go into all those. Okay, so I am simply putting the normal equations directly. Okay, so in case of polynomial regression, okay, so and especially with regard to universal kriging, okay, so I need to satisfy a lot of properties. Okay, so sum of all these coefficients must reach to one, and the coefficients of all these first order xi's, okay, so they must satisfy x0, and similarly the linear combination of yi's must satisfy with y0 and so on. Okay, so this is what using universal kriging is all about. Okay, so and we need to fit this particular kriging model, and this particular kriging model also suffers from it curse of dimensionality. Okay, so based on my previous discussion, you must have understood this point, namely curse of dimensionality, because if you, as we are dealing with a large number of spatial locations, and we are computing the correlation matrix among all those spatial locations, also my model involves inverse of that particular correlation matrix. Okay, so computation of inverse of such a large matrix, okay, high dimensional matrix, large size matrix, okay, so is memory hungry, and while solving the problem, we have to look at many characteristics of the matrix, okay, in terms of the positive definiteness and all. Okay, so we need to satisfy a lot of issues, a lot of constraints to compute that particular R inverse. Okay, so we cannot deal with such a large space with regard to the data also. Okay, so there is a curse of dimensionality. So in order to address that, what is that normally people do is they go for sampling. Okay, so instead of accommodating every design site into the model, we can accommodate samples of that particular design space, and we can take those samples and we can fit the model. Okay, so here you could see here, so instead of selecting every source region pixel, I am selecting the alternate layer. Okay, so here this is about all locations are selected, all source locations are selected, and here our alternate locations are selected. Okay, so this rectangular box is about source location, this circular oval stands for, this particular circular shape stands for the in-plane region. Okay, so from a source region I can select every location, or I can select alternate locations. Okay, so this is how my sampling can help me to handle that particular curse of dimensionality with regard to computation of R inverse. Okay, so this is one aspect. The second aspect is I am talking about the correlation, and even that correlation also can be specified in terms of mathematical equations in closed form. And what is the closed form you are choosing? Okay, so there are plenty of correlation kernels available in literature, and which one you are going to choose that, okay, for the problem at hand. Okay, so and as far as the correlation kernels are concerned, one of them is about exponential correlation. Okay, and another one can be about Gaussian kernel correlation and linear, and another one can be a cubic. Okay, so these correlations we need to choose, one of them we need to choose. Okay, and so this correlation is specified in terms of one direction, and as we are dealing with two-dimensional data, okay, so to talk about the correlation across two dimensions, what is that I do is I take up the correlation along each dimensions, and I take the product of those correlations. Okay, so together I call it as my overall correlation in two dimensions. Okay, so correlation along x and y dimensions is specified or computed in terms of the product of a correlation along x-axis as well as y-axis. Okay, now if you see here, in this particular kernel, correlation kernel with regard to exponential, okay, here there are two terms, theta and d. Okay, so this d stands for distance, okay, the radial value. Okay, so distance, and theta is about the direction. Okay, so now we see, as I already mentioned, we are dealing with the two-dimensional data. So that is why this subscript P is being mentioned. So the capital theta is two-dimensional vector. Okay, and so I am putting P, P ranges from 1 to 2. Okay, so see, this theta specifies the direction along x-axis with theta 1, along y-axis theta 2. Okay, similarly, along x-axis, the distance is d1, along y-axis, distance is about d2. Okay, so now you see, I am defining my correlation kernel in terms of this particular exponential basis, okay, which is sensitive to the distance as well as direction. Okay, so this correlation is defined, well defined in terms of this intuition. Okay, and that particular correlation, okay, can be depicted in the form of plots. Okay, so you see here, so my correlation can be same across both the directions. Okay, be it about theta 1 direction or theta 2 direction, along both the direction my correlation, if it remains same, such a correlation is called as isotropic correlation. The correlation, spatial correlation, changes from direction to direction, then it is called as anisotropic correlation. You see, I started my discussion with the imposition of regularity in terms of anisotropy, and that anisotropy is manifested in terms of the correlation kernel. Okay, so this correlation kernel is going to influence the error value. Okay, so the error model. And so if you choose this particular correlation kernel, so the error remains same across all the directions, both the directions. If I choose this kernel, error changes from direction to direction. Okay, so this particular analogy, okay, has got many solutions or many interpretations or instances in real world. Okay, so supposing that if you have a factory chimney, okay, and the influence of that particular emission of that particular factory chimney in terms of the gases, okay, is felt by the neighborhood, and the entire neighborhood will not be affected at the same level. Okay, rather it is influenced by different parameters like wind direction and so on. Okay, so in real world, so there are a lot of instances wherein this anisotropy gets manifested. Okay, and we need to understand that particular philosophy or phenomena, and we need to model that in our solution. Okay, so and again, there is an important question here. Okay, so how do you determine that particular theta? Okay, so I am talking about theta, okay, as a vector which works along theta 1 direction as well as theta 2 direction. Okay, so how do you initialize that particular theta? Okay, so initialization of theta is also a big problem. Okay, so in machine learning, okay, so we call them as the hyperparameters. We need to tune these hyperparameters, and so one of the hyperparameter tuning models is about Q-consume model. Okay, so we refer to that as a pattern search algorithm. Okay, yes, we are all computer science guys. Okay, so while solving optimization problems, okay, so we need not implement the very sophisticated or very complex the optimization algorithms, okay, or even SWAM algorithms. We can simply go for the exploitation and exploration based algorithms. One of them is the Q-consume. Okay, so you just take it as a take home point, and you try to explore how exactly this Q-consume algorithm works in pattern matching. Okay, so I am looking for some pattern in an area. Okay, I want to quickly arrive at that particular location where this pattern is available. Okay, so this is a very sophisticated problem. Okay, and one of the solutions, better solutions, is about the hook and chief. Okay, so why we deal with this particular hook and chief algorithm is it is free from derivatives. Okay, so while solving optimization problems, we are looking for the optimal solutions. So we need to explore the entire solution space, and while exploring that particular solution space, okay, so we need to solve a minimization problem or maximization problem, and all the times we cannot afford to deal with the gradient based approaches, because gradient may not be available, okay, at certain locations. In that case, we need to implement a non-gradient, okay, or gradient free optimization algorithm. Okay, so one of them is about the hook and chain. Okay, so by combining all these aspects, okay, so I arrived at this algorithm named the SEI, spatial anisotropic interpolation algorithm, and I have solved certain problems. Okay, so the first problem that I am demonstrating here is So there is a text that is being overlaid on the image. Okay, and such a text can be removed. Okay, so I have removed that by applying this particular SA algorithm. Okay, by means of implementing the kriging. Okay, which is anisotropic in nature. Okay, and I compared that my solution with the so-called seminal papers. Okay, and while I was working with that problem. Okay, so Betalmeyer work was considered as the pioneered work in that particular area. So you see, if you compare my work with the Betalmi work, okay, so Betalmi algorithm failed to reconstruct all the structures. You see, so this pole is been broken. Okay, so at multiple locations the structures are damaged. Okay, so but in case of my solution, this SCI solution, the anisotropy solution, the structures are preserved. Okay, now you see, you please appreciate. So regression is a simpler model, machine learning model, and the problem at hand is very complex, namely in painting. Okay, and so such a complex problem also can be solved by means of such a simpler models. Okay, so regression is bread and butter for a machine learning guy. Okay, by tuning that particular machine learning algorithm named regression, okay, based on the nature of the problem, we can get better results. Okay, so this is the first demonstration. With regard to the closer look, you see the pole is totally obscured here. Okay, because of this character L, okay, the pole is been obscured. Okay, and algorithm SCI regression algorithm is able to reconstruct the entire pole, though lot of information is missing over here. Okay, similarly the curvilinear structures are also preserved. Okay, you can verify that. Okay, and but the same problem cannot be solved, cannot be used to solve large scale problems. Okay, so the same model, okay, SCI model cannot be used to solve large scale problems, because so large scale problems might turn into extrapolation problems. Okay, so but whereas this kriging is good at interpolation, okay, rather than extrapolation. But while solving certain large scale problems, okay, so we may not have an interpolation characteristic. In that case, we need to handle this problem more prudently. Okay, so there also we need to go for feature engineering on our own. Okay, that feature engineering is just look at this. Okay, given this particular image, okay, earlier I mentioned about one sampling technique, either by means of picking up every other in paint region location, every other source region location. Okay, instead of throwing away certain pixels. Okay, so what is that we can do is, so from the given input image, we can extract multiple sub images and we can work on all the sub images simultaneously. And once we get the results of the partial images or sub images, we can combine them to get the overall solution. Okay, now you could see, so based on my talk or my explanation, there may be multiple intuitions in your mind. Why can't we implement that by means of multi-threading? Why can't we implement that this particular algorithm by means of map reduce, all that? Okay, see, so one particular solution, okay, so leads to the new ideas and new technologies. Okay, so my sampling scheme I have modified. So instead of throwing away certain pixels, what is that I am doing? I am retaining all the pixels, but not in a single image, but they are scattered across multiple images. Okay, all the sub images are handled independently and the partial results are combined into overall solution. This is what you could see here. So I have got the larger input image. I want to remove this particular bungee. Okay, this person from the image. I cannot handle this directly using this particular kriging. So what is that I am doing? I am sampling. Okay, that sampling is about hierarchical sampling. Okay, so from this image, I am extracting four sub images. Okay, and how exactly that sampling is done is depicted over here. All dots are solid dots are placed into one sub image. All hollow dots are placed into one sub image. All diamonds are placed into another sub image, and stars are placed into certain final image. Okay, so if this particular sub image is also not manageable, then I repeatedly apply this my sampling. Okay, and I arrange all the images, sub images in a hierarchical manner, and I solve the problems at the bottom of the pyramid, and I try to reconstruct the original image from those partial results. Okay, so this is what my my intuition towards solving the large scale link painting problems. And again, also, I need to work about the correlation tensors. Okay. And I also need to determine which particular polynomial need to be used, all that. Okay. So in that case, okay, so there is a involved issue, namely as to which particular basis you are going to choose. Okay, so as far as my problem is concerned, we need to select the basis. Okay, so which basis need to be used. Okay, so if I talk at that particular problem, okay, so one of the approaches is to take up a higher order polynomial. You fit that. Okay, obviously it suffers from overfitting, and just to avoid that particular overfitting, what is that I do is I go for regularization. Okay, so once I apply a regularization mechanism, certain coefficients of my regression will get die off, and the remaining coefficients will give the improved results. Okay, so that is what you could see here. So this is my regression solution. Okay, generalized least square regression solution. And this is the nature of the characteristic or nature of the coefficients beta 1 and beta 2. Okay, so if I apply regularization on top of that, you could see here this particular generalized least square solution and regularization term, both of them are meeting on this y on the beta 2 axis. And we all know that on beta 2 axis, beta 1 is 0. Okay, so resulting solution has got only one element, namely beta 2. Okay, so this is what the sparsity is all about. This is what regularization is all about. Unnecessary contribution of B1 is avoided by means of regularizing this nature of the solution. Okay, but if you go for this ridge regression, you could see here this particular generalized least square solution and this particular parameter space are meeting at this law at this point, wherein both betas are valid. Okay, so we want to avoid this. This is what sparsity is all about. Okay. So in order to implement that, a lot of libraries or packages are available. One of them is about elastic net regularization. Okay, so I have applied that. Okay, and to determine the nature of the anisotropy, I have also invoked the Hurst exponent component extraction. Okay, and so by working on all those, I came up with algorithm. I refer to that as scalable spatial anisotropic algorithm, interpolation algorithm, and I was able to solve large scale problems also. Now you see, this is very interesting. So I have got a large scale region to get filled. Okay, this entire region to get filled by utilizing the little information available in the vicinity. Okay, by upon applying this scalable spatial anisotropic interpolation, which involves a hierarchical sampling, I am able to solve this. See, entire line. The structure is preserved. Okay. And if I don't regularize the original solution, this is how my the overfitting problem comes in. Okay, so the overfitting can be avoided by means of regularization, and I got the better result. Similarly, I am showing one more example here. So here there are two holes here. Okay, so these two holes are filled by algorithm. Okay, and you try to appreciate the beauty of this. There are diversified pieces of information. There are different patterns available at different locations. A single model is able to address all these signatures or templates, okay, simultaneously. Okay, so if in the absence of that particular regularization, okay, so we suffer from some low fidelity results. Okay, so you could see a lot of results, better results, okay, in terms of creation of structures, implementation or synthesis of textures, okay, removal of unnecessary objects from the images. Okay, so now you see there is a statue and I have removed the statue. Okay, and there is a person here, I have removed that person. Okay, so there is a baseball player here. Okay, so I have removed him from that image, and I have compared that with the seminal papers. Okay, so in this particular area, okay, namely areas which is a non-local total variation minimization, okay, model. Okay, and this particular simpler machine learning model is going to defeat all other models. Okay, so in terms of the performance, okay, which is measured in terms of fidelity and certain parameters. Okay, so this is how, what is that I want to summarize is, if you properly model your algorithm, okay, and if you understand the parameters of that model, and if you understand the nature of the hyperparameters that are involved, if you try to learn them okay, and if you implement them in the algorithm, okay, so then you are deemed to get better results, okay, so even without worrying about very complex models. Okay, so simpler model can be casted onto solving a complex real world problems. Okay, so this is what machine learning model for the in painting. And so nowadays we are also talking about deep learning models. Okay, so to solve the same problem. Okay, so and I quickly give you the overview of anyway, I have got prepared a lot of slides. Okay, so there are very interesting topics in this particular area, and we all know that GAN model, okay, so generative adversarial network model is a revolutionary idea in deep learning, and people started applying that particular GAN model to solve this in painting very recently. Okay, so I'm not going into the details of all these GAN structures. Okay, so my interest is to solve this problem named the image in painting. Okay, so you see, so if I try to solve this problem using machine learning, I cannot solve. Okay, see, if I use a single image and if I try to impute the values at this location, okay, so this is how I suffer from. Okay, these are all the artifacts I get. Okay, be it about patch match algorithm or cricking algorithm, any algorithm, so they are not good at solving this problem because the relevant information is not available in the source region. Given in a single image, I don't have relevant information in the source region. Okay, so that is why these algorithms. Okay, so if we simply invoke the patch match algorithm or cricking algorithm on top of that, we suffer from such artifacts. Okay, so in order to overcome that, invariably we have to learn this data from other images, from samples, lot of samples, and so if you implement the deep learning model, okay, which is learning knowledge from multiple images, okay, so then there is a possibility to reproduce those missing elements, okay, so in a beautiful manner. And one of them is about GLICC, okay, so globally locally consistent image completion. Okay, so this is considered to be a very powerful model in deep learning area with regard to solving this image in painting. Okay, we are running out of time to talk about all that. Okay, so it is already 1:45, so I apologize for slippage in terms of time. Okay, so I'll simply conclude by highlighting this particular diagram. Okay, so you see here I have got a completion network, okay, so which is a dilated convolution network. Okay, this is my generative model. Okay, so and I have got discriminator model. Okay, the output of the generator model is being verified by the discriminator. Instead of having just one global discriminator, this particular author has also implemented a local discriminator. Okay, so at the time of discrimination, global information as well as local information, both of them are verified. Okay, and this generator function will get tuned, will get modified. Okay, so based on the responses of the discriminator, eventually generator can generate a output which cannot be discriminated by the discriminator. With that, my GAN model will converge, and we'll get a better results of that. Okay, so and there are a lot of issues. Okay, so and within 1 hour we cannot talk about all that. Okay, so I apologize for not being in a position to cover all these aspects that I aspire to cover. Okay, so see, using this particular GAN models, okay, so yes, by using the local as well as global information, we can solve certain real world problems, but these solutions are power hungry, these solutions are memory hungry, these solutions take a lot of time to get converged. Okay, so they cannot work in real time. Okay, that is the problem with these deep learning models. Okay, so with this, I'll stop my discussion. Okay, so by giving a simple suggestion, a caution to all the audience. Okay, so namely, these AI algorithms, okay, are also capable of spoiling our culture, okay, by influencing with fake evidences. Okay, so that is what you could see. You must have heard about this particular algorithms named the deepfake algorithms. By using GAN models, people started synthesizing the videos. Okay, wherein a celebrity is being made to speak about certain things that he never spoke about in his real life. Okay, so this is what deepfake is all about. Okay, so and we must be in a position to threat ourselves or protect ourselves from such a deep fake attacks on our private contents. Okay, so I want to suggest you that whenever you post some image onto the social media, never post any low resolution images. Okay, so all high resolution images they can protect themselves from such a deep fake attacks. Okay, so this is the simple intuition or thumb rule we have to follow. Okay, whenever we post certain contents onto the social media, you always post high resolution. Okay, be it about video or image, you always put high resolution content on that. Okay, so such a high resolution content can protect itself from such attacks, deep fake attacks. Okay, so with this, let me conclude my session. Okay, so and again, I thank all of you for your patient listening. And I also thank to the organizers of this particular FTP for giving me this particular opportunity to share my understandings on image in painting. Okay, so by means of machine learning as well as deep learning. Okay, so with this, let me stop my session. And if you have any queries, I'm ready to take. If you have any questions or queries,
thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Participants are requested to post their queries if you have any.
Yeah. So I request you to either post your query or you can ask through microphone also.
Yes, you can unmute yourself and you can ask the query.
So this particular area is multidisciplinary. It is not specific to one topic or one science. Okay, so there is a signal processing. Okay, so there is a audio video synthesis. Okay, so image processing. See how many dimensions are there to this particular problem. Okay, so and we are very fortunate to have beautiful libraries. Okay, in Python. Okay, and OpenCV. Okay, we can work on them and we can make our hands dirty. And we can also contribute towards that particular solution space. Okay, so and if you look at the authors of all these articles, okay, revolutionary articles, you could see many Indians behind those ideas. Okay, so who are working for Google, okay, so Facebook, so they are working thoroughly on these problems and they are contributing to this particular area, okay, in an elegant manner. Okay, so let us also aspire to contribute to this space. Okay, so through our efforts. So if you have any questions, I'm ready to take. If there is no question, I call it a day. I apologize for not being in a position to present all the slides.
Hope we can share that slides to participants, sir. That's not an issue.
Sure.
Yeah, so you please mail those slides to Sridhar sir. So he will be sharing all the things with the participants.
Yeah, thank you.
So I hope there are no more questions from participants. So let us conclude the session, sir. Yeah, thank you so much, Raghav sir, for your time being with us and sharing all your valuable insights regarding the topic called deep learning. And you have clearly explained the things regarding your image classifications. Yeah. And things are clear. Thank you for accepting as the resource person for this session, sir. Thank you so much.
Yeah, so indeed, I'm privileged to serve this session.
Yeah, thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Dear participants, our afternoon session will be like you have quiz. So the session will start sharp at 2:30 p.m. The quiz link will be kept open for half an hour. And the quiz consists of 20 questions. So you are requested to join short by 2:30 p.m. Thank you. And this quiz link will not be shared in the WhatsApp group. So please consider this and please join by 2:30 p.m. Thank you.